Okay. Gimana, Sam?
Everything is all right.
How are you doing?
All right.
All right.
Okay. There we go. Okay. Now, I'm here with Gary Undarsa.
Hello.
He is the co-founder of Tiket.com. And thank you for being here, Gary. And you know what? This is the very first edition or the first episode of the show.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. What a privilege. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for coming.
Yes.
How
yes.
are you?
I'm good. I'm good so far. And actually, this is the first time that I do an actual live interview, not by Zoom or Google Meet, like for the past 1.5 years. So yeah.
Really?
Yeah, also the first for me.
Oh, wow.
During the pandemic. I feel that it's the right time, right? I think that there has to be someone that's gonna speak for the industry, I feel, right? Because the thing is, I mean, like travel industry, I think it's the industry that actually really get the most impact out of this pandemic, as in negative impact, right? But also, if you think about it, actually there are lots of transformations and a lot of interesting perspective, you know, for the future, right? I mean, like everything is changing nowadays. If you ask me, I mean, like some part of it is not so good, but actually if we look at the bigger picture, there is always that bigger dream out of it, right? So yeah, I'm
okay.
Yes.
Save that story
yes,
for later.
Yes,
yeah?
Of course. Yeah.
Okay, let's start. Let's start with a question on what's your role in Tiket.com,
sure.
and including how you get started in this field, and how you get started in this field? It can go back to the life in or after Vancouver, your Vespa,
sure.
your outdoor activities, leadership. I'm aware that you are involved in some organizations
yeah,
also,
yeah.
and of course the Tiket.com and its achievement.
Right.
Yeah.
That's a lot of things going on, but actually, I think we can start from where it began, right? If you ask me, I think the real the thing that I learned in my life, right? I think one of the very first big step that I took was actually when I moved back from Canada, Vancouver, Canada, to Indonesia, like you mentioned before, right? Why is it such a big step? Because the thing is, when I went to Canada, right? I actually had no intention to come back to Indonesia.
Oh,
in
really?
General. The reason is because I think, you know, back in early 2000s lah, I mean like back there, I mean like we always think that North America or the Western countries are the place to go, you know, like in the 2000s, right?
Right.
It always been, you know, the dream has always been like living there, the American dream or the Canadian dream, whatever it is.
Yeah.
I mean like and just get a good job, properties and everything, and that's it, you know? And like, as a matter of fact, I did that, you know? I did that for some years until the year of 2010, right?
Okay.
2010.
So you've been there for?
For almost 10 years, right?
Oh,
I don't
right.
know, eight plus years,
okay.
right? Mostly there, I mean like, I barely come back to Indonesia actually, probably every 2 years, right? And like whenever I'm in Indonesia, I was only like a week or like maximum 2 weeks, and that's it. So like, right?
What did you study?
What
was your major?
Oh, computing science and business administration. So I took joint major, okay. in right there. So I did that, right? And then I realized that after I graduated, what I did was I did not actually contribute back to the country, as in Indonesia, right? Even though for the first 20-something years of my life, it's all about supported by rupiah, right? But then after that, when I get the skills, you know, when I get the knowledge, what happened is that I practically forgotten about where I came from, right? So I just feel obligated that, hey, you know what, this country, I mean, like, I was born there and, like, I was raised and even, like, got to this point because of rupiah, so-called, right? But then what happened after that, I used dollars everywhere. Doesn't make sense. So because of that, I decided to took a 3 months leave of absence, basically sabbatical leave for 3 months. I went back to Indonesia with only one mission. I just want to know whether, quote-unquote, Indonesia can actually provide me with my future growth, right? As simple as that. You know, I just want to know what's going on here, you know? Because the thing is, I mean, all people always saying that Indonesia is always a still developing countries, you know, like they're like behind from all these western countries for 10 years behind and all those things, right? When I came back, I realized that, hey, you know what? I think Southeast Asia in general, or like specifically Indonesia, this will be the next big thing in the economy of the world, right? I mean, like America, US, very mature already. China, I mean, like in 2010, they're already big, right? India as well. So I was thinking where to go next, right? Indonesia is the fourth largest population in the world. So, I mean, it just makes sense, right, to think about that. And not just that, we actually have a lot of things here that you really cannot buy, right? Which is, well, as simple as the natural resource for sure, you know, and we have a lot of people here, like 275 million people. That one you definitely cannot buy, right? I mean, like, so what does it mean? It means that we have a lot of potential customers just from the domestic market. So the domestic market is huge, has lots of potentials, but the only problem is this one. Not many people actually putting their time and effort to really give solutions to these people, you know? It can be anything, right? It can be just as simple as providing a simpler buying experience. In our case, we look at the travel opportunity, right? We look at the travel industry, tourism industry. Simple. As simple as, you know what, Indonesia, you practically cannot replicate Bali. A lot of countries has tried, right? And not even one close, right? So what I'm trying to say is that you cannot replicate what we have here as a country. And I think there has to be someone that's brave enough, that's gonna focus on this, and that has been our vision lah. You know, we really want to transform the industry, and I think right now the vision actually even a bit bigger. We want to be the most customer-centric travel company in Southeast Asia, right? Yes, we want to be the biggest for sure, always. I mean, like, everyone tries to be the biggest. Everyone tries to be number one. But I feel that the most important part in order for us to get there is actually our customer. And that's why our vision is actually to be the most customer-centric travel company. Because when we are customer-centric, then everything else just follows, right? I think that's just a simple thing, right? When you as a customer happy with our service, with our product, then you're gonna come back, right? So I think that's the idea. And following that, right, I finally came back to Indonesia. It was a crazy day. It was crazy. What happened was that I decided, okay, you know what? I wanted to go back to Indonesia. So I went to Vancouver just for 2 weeks. What I did was basically on my first day, I listed my apartment, right? Second day, I sold my car. Right, I sold my apartment within the third day, and then like within a week, I practically sold everything inside the apartment. Like literally everything. The only thing that's left is just my bed, right? And it's not the frame. It's just the bed, right? I mean, of course, because I still need it for the next week, right? So that's what happened. I mean, within a week, it's gone, and I was like, you know what? I think it's happening. So I went back with only 4 luggages, and that's it. And like I never look back, because the thing is, when I arrived here, it's not so nice. I mean, like, for the first 1 year, it was practically nothing happening.
Almost 10 years living abroad.
Yes, after almost 10 years living there, I had a good community, I had a good asset, I had a good job. I mean, like, it was quite a big company. It was IBM. It was an interesting company as well. But then the one thing that really differs, distinguished between living in Western countries and here, right, in Indonesia specifically, is the opportunity, you know, right? That's it. I mean, like, I feel that there has to be something else that I can do and somehow I can contribute, you know. I always believe that the most important thing in our life is actually making an impact in wherever, right? Of course, in your family, you need to make an impact, right? In like even in school, or like in this case, at your office, or like even like in the bigger scheme of things, in your country, right? For the people around you, right?
Correct.
How can you make an impact right here? If I were to go back to Indonesia, I need to make an impact to Indonesian people, right? You know what? If you remember travel industry 10 years ago, can you even imagine, like, in order for you to buy a flight ticket So another problem was that what I realized, Indonesia is an island country, and there is no way you can connect this island without airlines, right? I mean, it's just very impractical if you just use boats, for example, right? So I feel that there has to be a good solution out of it. Simple. There has to be a place that we can just throw that information in one place somehow, and people can just browse, get all those informations, and hopefully they can compare the prices. Hopefully they can compare the schedules. As simple as that. Hopefully they somehow can just choose whatever they want, buy there, and you get the ticket right away on your phone, right? But remember, 2010, there was no smartphones. There was only Blackberries, right? So we actually thought about that even before Android, right? So we really want that to happen. So, but then we need to follow, right? We started with a website, and then mobile site, and then after that we started to move on to, hey, you know what, I think apps are going to be big. So we were one of the very first company in Indonesia that actually invested in apps. You know, we actually built our apps like literally in the beginning. And one interesting fact is that we are the pioneer for online travel in Indonesia. Like literally we are the first one. We were the first one who did it. We were the first one who finally managed to convince the airlines to finally sell their tickets online. We are also the first one who actually managed to sell concert tickets online. 2010, if you were to buy concert tickets, what you need to do, you actually need to go to a place, line up for like, I don't know, like 6 hours or so, right? Like, it doesn't make sense. So actually what we're trying to build is not impossible.
But what happened back then, I mean, you and your partners were thinking that, okay, apps is going to be big.
Yeah.
What happened at that time? I mean...
You know what? The interesting bit is this. There has to be that one small step, or like big step, right? So what happened was that one of my partner, which is the strategic guy, call it, right? This guy always dream. You know, this guy is the dreamer. This guy always like think about what's gonna happen in the next 5 years, you know? So he's not interested of what's happening today. He's interested on what can happen, what's the opportunity, right?
And those are friends from the old days?
No, it's not. Oh. So this is another interesting fact. Me and my partners, we did not know each other until Tiket.com. Yeah, so we met by chance. And in a way, I think it was good, because we had a lot of fights during business in partnership, right? Not everyone can be comfortable, or like not everyone can be like click, you know, like with anyone, right? And the good thing is we're not friends back then.
Right.
Back then we were not friends, so we were just like, you know, professional business partners.
How did you meet each other?
It was funny lah. It was like friends of
friends of
friends. Because the thing is, We had this project. This is not Tiket.com, and actually they actually had this other projects with the banks. It started from there. Why?
How many of you?
Right now there are three.
Okay.
Right now there are three. In the beginning we started with six, so like there were a lot. But then again, you know, like business partnership, right? Which is fine. The interesting bit is why I'm glad we were not friends, because we fought a lot. So if we were friends, you know, if we were friends in the beginning, probably we would not feeling comfortable to actually express what we think.
Correct.
Right? And we probably...
You don't want to hurt your friends,
Yes, of course, I wouldn't want to hurt my friends' feeling, right? Or like opinions to whatever it is. I think what makes the partnership very strong until today is because we always feel each other's weaknesses, you know? I mean, like me and my partners, we were very different. Like literally the way we think, super different. The way we work, very different. The way we talk, very different. What we like, very different. Until today, we do not have any hobbies in common at all. Like we do not go to the movies together. Like the only thing that we have in common is just that. It's just one thing. We love food, right?
Okay.
So we always have lunch every single day together. And I think that's what bond us for this, I don't know, a couple of years, right? So we love food. We kept trying on all these restaurants across Jakarta. I think that's very interesting, because like during lunch, I mean, you just have this wonderful discussions, right?
Right.
So
those ideas will come.
And then after that, I mean, of course, throughout the years, you build that friendship becomes family, right? So and right now we were like one big family lah to each other, you know. But then it was like 10 years.
Yeah.
So if you ask me, I think real partnership, it took time. You know?
I want to go back to your story earlier. You mentioned it before.
Sure.
That, you know, you decided to go home,
mm-hmm.
and you said that you never regret it.
Of course, yes.
And I want to know why.
Mm-hmm, mm. Very, very, very good question, and I like it. You know what? I think, well, there are two parts of the story, right? The one part is the one that I always say to everyone, right? Of course, the career, Tika.com, right? I mean, like, if I did not come back to Indonesia, I'm still gonna play that small role in that big company in Canada somewhere, and that's it. You know, probably it was okay. I mean, like, I will be okay, but that's it. I mean, like, I will not have that accomplishment where I feel that I make an impact, right? But right here in Indonesia, I actually make real impact every single day, even until today. Do you know what happened? I mean, like, one of the most enlightening moment, yeah, for me, yeah, 2013. Back then, PT KAI Indonesia, which is the public rail company here, they were undergoing this big transformation in the management, right? Pak Jonan, Ignatius Jonan, were the one who lead the company. So we met him, we had this discussion. Simple, he just asked, "Hey, you know what? What do you think you guys are the ticketing guys, right? You guys are the young guys, you know, like, what would you suggest that the rail company should do?"
Did you and your team come to him, make appointment, or know each other before?
No. It was like, back then we had this, we had a mentor, okay, right? And then we just asked, "Hey, can you connect us with Pak Jonan?" And then it somehow it just happened, which is great. And then we did that during the conversation, and then we just told him the story about Indian railways. In India, everything is already online, you know, like, and also they process like millions of tickets every day, no issues. Why can't we do it here in Indonesia? The scope is much smaller, right? There was a lot of problems within the operations of the train companies, right? And then because that, so we supported them from the technology and idea side. And then we actually, the first company that actually sold train tickets online. We were the first one. We were the first one even beyond anyone else. And then after that, it happened, right? Pak Jonan said that right now, everything has to be online 100%. That was crazy. That was crazy. We could not believe it. And then boom, you know, literally within a night, from 2013, every Lebaran period, no one actually slept on the station.
Correct.
Anymore. Because before that, for I don't know how many years, whenever you want to get that train tickets, you need to literally slept on the station, and you need to haggle with all those like people that's actually selling it from the black market, right? And sometimes it's not even a real ticket, right? And like people cannot sit down on the train. Right now, everyone has to sit. You know, like that's actually, I mean, we actually made that impact. Until today, it's still happening, right? Can you imagine like hundreds of millions of people that actually went to the train for the past 7 to 8 years? We were there. You know, that's the kind of impact that I was talking about. Like, it's not flight, it's not hotels and all this. There are lots of other stories, right? But again, that's the professional side of things, right? There is always that two sides of story. Another side of the story is my personal thing, right? My personal life. I was really glad because I went back to Indonesia in 2010, because when I came back to Indonesia, like just within 2 months, I did not know anyone. Literally, I only know my family. I lose track of my high school friends. I did not know anyone, and also my family was not business people. They were just, I mean, like my dad is a doctor, my mom is a art designer, right? Designer of clothing, right? So I mean, that's it, right? So, but what happened was that somehow, literally randomly, I met my wife. I met my future wife just 2 months I'm here, right? So that happened, and then that basically changed my life, right?
Correct. You don't want to go back.
Yeah, I mean, like, that's one thing, and then that actually make you realize that, hey, you know what? There is always, I mean, this is my motto in life, yeah. Like this past 20 years, I always use this motto. Everything happens for a very good reason. I mean, a lot of people's, the way they say it is, everything happens for a reason. But I don't take that. What I believe is everything happens for a very good reason.
Regardless what the circumstances are.
Because the thing is, if you just say everything happens for a reason, then you're gonna try to find a reason for it. So it's like, for example, something bad happened to you and you're like, hey, this is a reason, okay, probably I'm just not good enough, you know? Probably this is just bad. You know, probably, yeah, I'm just not good enough lah. I mean, like, that's the reason. But when you think that everything happens for a very good reason, then even though it's actually a bad thing that happened to you, you believe that, you know what, actually this happens because probably there is something even better that's gonna come into my life, right, later on. And I think that's what I believe in, because the thing is, I came back to Indonesia, I had a project that I was supposed to do, it was canceled. So, like, for the first 3 months, I literally had no job, or even more, I forgot, like, literally had no job. What I did every day, I just tried to make connections to new people, right? That's what I did every single day. My mom actually asked me, hey, did you actually make a good decision to come back? Because the thing is, like, you practically have not done anything for the past, at that time, I think it was almost 6 months already. I mean, like, no, I mean, like, nothing major, you know, everything is just, like, random stuff. But I always believe that, you know, there has to be something, right? And then during that time, I actually worked in a department store. That was my first job here in Jakarta, right? A department store CEO, I know her, and she was actually the one.
What did you do at the department store? I mean, which division?
It's actually very funny. It was a business analyst.
Okay.
So I worked behind desk, and I was just looking at this inventories. So I know the reason why a certain color is being put on the display. And also I know why every mall has different display. There is a reason behind it, apparently. There is a science behind it. Yeah, it was very interesting. Like South Jakarta people, what they like, what color, right? They like greens, they like browns. They like natural and earth colors. But if you go to the north, you know, like North Jakartan people, they love colorful things. They love red, they love yellow, they love like purple, like everything that literally like sharp to your eyes. So like you put that on the shelf. So the way they put things on the shelf also very different. Looking at the, you know, like looking at the historical whatever. So I learned that, which is got me thinking on a lot of things, you know. So it was interesting. So it was interesting. So if you ask me, again, I mean, like, back to my point, everything happens for very good reasons. And I went there because I work in a department store. Somehow I met my future partners at Tika.com during that time as well, right? And yeah, I mean, like, the rest is history, right? Okay. Even though it was a long history.
You have very interesting hobbies, yeah, outdoor activities, yeah. And also Vespa. And does your wife support that?
No, okay. This is also another thing. You know, one thing that I learned.
Because you're gonna spend a lot of money on that, you know, and wife usually will be.
Okay. I think this is the biggest problem and the biggest misunderstanding.
Okay.
Of husbands in general, you know, especially wives to husbands. Because the thing is this. I mean, like, the thing that I learned from my parents, especially my mom. My parents literally never gave me like all these luxury things in my life, like never. They always say to me, even when I was still a kid, yeah. They always say to me, you know what? Never expected anything from us. That's what they say, you know. And also they also said, you know what? You need to be able to pay for your own things. You try that. Of course, in the beginning they help, you know. So actually, there is this interesting fact that my parents only helped me pay in Canada for the first 2 years. Starting on my third year, I started to make money on my own. Doing whatever. I cannot work there, so I just did this trading, online trading, as in like I bought things on eBay from China, and after that I sold it using Craigslist within the Greater Vancouver. I got a profit. I just did that, you know. I just did that. So, and then after that I work, right? I took an internship and stuff like that. So I'd be able to pay my bills. And like by doing that, it actually taught me a lot of things. One is actually try your best to not waste anything. Try your best, right? Sometimes you need to enjoy things in life, but most of the times try to not waste anything. So what does he mean by that is that I was a very calculative person lah.
That's
so like,
good.
So like I know exactly why I'm spending that money. Why? Mm-hmm. And also I know exactly how much money I'm gonna get out of this spending in general, right? And that kind of carried over a bit right now. I mean, it used to be really bad. Everything like was very calculated, right? It was really bad. But then when I got married, I had kids and stuff like that, I realized that, hey, you know what? Like some of the things I just need to enjoy, right? But then even like on my hobbies, I was for example, Vespas, right? As simple as that. Why Vespa? Why scooter? They're just old, right? I learned about the history. So the thing what I did, I always try to study about it before I went. You know, I did not came to the hobby because it's a trend. I went to the hobby because I like it. I really love it. I believe it. That's what happened. So I learned about the history. I learned about the history in price of Vespas, right? Is it increasing or not?
When was that?
I learned that just 1.5 years ago, 2 years ago. I was very fast in this kind of things. Usually I bought the books. So I had like all these books of Vespa. I know all the histories. I know all the series. I know which ones are actually rare. I know that which one that are actually okay to invest and stuff like that.
And your favorite one is?
So I had this one that's actually coming from the year 55 or 56, 1956, yeah. So that was crazy, very rare. And like, I just love it because it's, I feel that, can you imagine like something that came from the year 1956 and you can still just ride it as if it's new,
right?
And like even sometimes I just buy things new here and like it broke the next 6 months, right? I mean like, why can't just they make it as it used to be? I mean, which is true. So, I mean, those things, I mean, that's Vespas. I also, I like cars, right? The interesting part is that when I build a car, I like to build a car, right? So restorations and all those things. I like it because it kind of bring back the value to the car, right? So I always like adding values to it. And not just that, I mean like sometimes, and I just cannot see something that's not proper, you know? I mean, it just hurts my eyes. I just say it, you know? So it just has to be beautiful. But these beautiful things has to be able to be appreciated by everyone, not just anyone that likes Vespas or like in my case, Land Rovers, right? I like Land Rovers as well, you know? So, and I think that kind of replicated to what I do because I'm the marketing guy, right? At Ticket forever, right? And I think this is what makes me different comparing to my partners because my partners were really good in numbers. My partners were really good at strategy. My partners were really good at negotiating. What I'm good at is actually, I think I can see, how do you call it? Yeah, people say is that I have the eyes. I have the eyes of, I mean like identifying beautiful things, I would say. And also identifying which one that will be the trend. Identifying which one that the public would like, the colors, right? The shapes, whether it actually off by 1 pixel, for example, on the design. I mean, like I was the one. I mean, like actually, my creative team. Sometimes I get a bit into the details, you know, like whenever, for example, I saw this like TV commercials, right? As a presentation. So I just got to see, or like a design, a banner design. I was like, the thing that I commented usually is that detail, right? Outside the bigger ideas, right? Because I think detail is important, yeah. I mean, like, I think that what makes us different compared to others is actually on the details, right? So how can we create that perception? How can we create that perceptions where Tiket.com is the one that are really taking care of the customers, right? Tiket.com will always provide the best value for the customers. So, and also one thing, because we're talking about marketing stuff right now, there are three values that I always put in on the company, right? Everyone in the company has to know this. One is fast, we call it 3F. One is fast, right? Fast means that everything right now, nowadays, everything has to be fast. There is no more excuse for us to take our time. No, I mean, like, millennials, zillennials, they want instant gratification, right? They want it to be, I mean, like, if I want it right now, I want it right now. That's the reason why all these e-commerces can be successful in Indonesia, because they have this instant delivery. Like, I don't think any other country has a simple instant delivery like us, you know? We're actually very grateful we have that. Amazon in the US, they need to develop a system to make that same-day delivery. In Indonesia, very simple. Just work with...
one click, yeah, exactly. And that's it.
And also just work with all the motorcycles, that's it, right?
Yeah.
Motorcycle taxis. So there are a lot of things that we can do fast, you know, it has to be there. So anything that we do, especially in marketing, it has to reflect that fast value. Whenever we do advertising, for example, we like to do things that's not like very slow and like started to change, move. No, I mean, like, I was like, you know, I don't like that. I'm gonna say that. I like things that, for example, someone, they just open and they're bored, for example, they're bored, and then they look at the phone, look at apps, Tiket.com apps, they click, and then that second, they already changed place. They already moved to like somewhere else. So our very first TV advertising back in 2017, so we actually had this interesting TV commercial, which was actually, so the family was very bored, and then suddenly the grandmother came inside the house using a horse, right? I mean, this is Indonesian ways to do things, right? I mean,
was that idea come from you?
No. Okay. That was actually from the creative people.
Okay.
I was just like, I love it. I love the idea. So we put it there. And then this grandma, he's actually the one who's showing the phone, which is very weird because grandma shouldn't bring any phones, right?
Yeah.
And then that click, when that happens, literally within second, everything changes. They move to Bromo. In the middle of nowhere, in the middle of Bromo, everything changes. Everyone's surprised. Everyone was happy. So that kind of fast that we're trying to show. And also another thing is also flexibility. Another F. So one is fast. Second is flexibility. Mm-hmm. If you notice, flexibility, dynamic, right? Our company, the way we work, has to be very flexible to the demand, you know. And that's the reason why we put grandmother there, right? Because we want to show that at Tiket.com, you know, it has to be able to adapt to anyone, right? Even a grandma can actually use it.
If grandma can do it, then
especially you, right? I mean, it's also so
the youngsters
fast.
Can also
yeah,
do
exactly.
it. Yeah,
exactly. So that's what happened. And also number three, the last one, right? Which is actually friendliness. I always believe that whatever things that we do, especially we're Indonesian, the one traits that we can be proud of is that Indonesian is very friendly. That's how it is. So, but what I'm trying to say is that I think friendliness is something that should really out there. You know, people should be able to see Tiket.com brand as something that's very friendly. Tiket.com apps, something that's very friendly. Even your grandma can use it. You know, friendliness can be anything, right? Even our logo. If you ask me, I mean, this logo, why we put it like in the middle, and why is it yellow? You know, it's yellow in the middle because yellow resembles happiness. It means happiness, right? What is the emotion that comes to you whenever you think about traveling? Only one emotion. There is only happiness. you already think about, you book the ticket for the next 2 months, but you're already happy now. So we want to put that feeling into our logos. That's why we put yellow. Another detail, why is it circle? There's a circle, right?
About the color, did you learn it from the department store?
No, actually it is. Yes, part of it, it is. But actually, this is, of course, this is coming from the creative.
Yeah, creative team.
I mean, like, frankly speaking, I'm not the one who came up with all these crazy and creative ideas. Seriously, what I did was just, this is good, this is not.
Okay.
I got that privilege, thankfully, right? So, why is it circle? Because we believe that travel should not be limited. Yeah. It has no end. It has no end. It has no boundaries, right? We don't want to put corners on our logos, right? So that's why we put circle. And also, it also resembles with travel. You literally can go anywhere, endlessly, anytime, right? You can just go anywhere. And also another reason why the circle is bigger than the fonts. There's also a reason, because circle here in the middle means customer and also our partners. We always try to put customers and partners in the middle, in the center of our company and business, because they're the reason why we're here, and they are always bigger than us. You know, there are a lot of things going right. Another one. There are two more. One is the T. Why the T in the beginning is a lowercase, not uppercase? Because we believe at ticket.com, we are actually at the same level with everyone. So we're not higher. We're not smarter than you. We always say we try to be. I mean, like whoever we are, whether we're the number one or whatever it is, we always wanted to be humble. As simple as that. Because I think that's the Indonesian traits again, right? We need to have that. Last one. Why the I doesn't have the dot? Yep. Right? I mean, not many people recognize that or like even see that. But that's actually the small details that really matters, right? Why the I doesn't have dot? This actually came from our CEO. when he saw this logo, he was like, hey, you know what? That I doesn't have dot. I was like, hey, yeah, probably the creative team forgot about it, right? I mean, like, this is, oh, okay. We need to do something about it. He said, hey, you know what? No. This is good. Why? Because at ticket.com, there is no I, there is only you.
Oh!
I was like, whoa, that's amazing. I was like, okay, you know what? It's okay.
Was that some spontaneous?
Spontaneous,
or?
Yeah.
Oh,
spontaneous,
wow.
So we actually use it so it sticks here. So, yeah, I mean, like, even just looking at this logo. And also the funny thing is, we did not have any alternatives for this logo. At the pitching, this agency came to us and he was just like, and I asked him, okay, you know what? So how many logos do you have for us today so that we can choose? He said, you know what? After careful considerations and weeks of thoughts, we only will bring you one logo, right? If you like it, we're gonna work together. If you don't like it, we're just gonna go home. You know what? Even then, before I saw the logo, I already liked the idea because it shows boldness, right? In this business, especially in this industry, nowadays, everyone has to be able to be bold. And that's
good. Sure. And Gary, tourism industry is, as we all know, it's one of the sectors that most affected by the COVID-19
yes.
pandemic.
Yes,
okay?
By far.
Yes. And all governments around the world, they impose these travel restrictions, and Indonesia is no exception.
Yeah.
So, could you share with us what is the current condition of the Indonesian tourism at the moment? Yeah.
Right. So, tourism sector, not just in Indonesia, in the world, we got hit really bad. Can you imagine? February 2020 last year. Ticket.com was having the best month in the past 10 years. So that was like where our sales was the highest. Can you imagine that? That was February 2020. We were like, you know, we're going to have a great year, you know, like 2020. And then March 15, 2020, pandemic hits Indonesia and everything's like, shh. So March was like one of our worst months, right? So can you imagine from our best month in February, worst month on March? Right, everyone will be surprised, everyone panicking and stuff like that. But I think, again, we always try to look it from the opportunities, right? Of course, we're gonna look at the problems, right? We're gonna look at the problems. We're not trying to remove the problems or like just not think about it. We think about the problem. We always kept building, right? But the thing is, we try to see it from the opportunistic side of things. We're trying to see it from the optimistic side of things. A lot of travel companies, whether it's online or offline, during this pandemic, what they did, of course, laying off people, which makes sense. I mean, like, I had no problem with that because sometimes you had no business. So what can you do, right? And not just that, I think they kept focusing on the problem itself, right? What we did, thankfully, we did not have to lay off anyone, even one person, because of the pandemic, right? What we did, actually, we allocate people to build the things that people's gonna need during this pandemic. You know, for example, we have this feature called Smart Refund and Smart Reschedule, right? Before that, whenever people wants to refund and reschedule, they need to call, they need to emails. I mean, it takes some actions, some steps. During this pandemic, because like we had nothing else to do, right? We cannot do campaign or promotions. We put our effort there. It went live. So right now, whenever you want to do refund and reschedule, literally one click away, right? It's important because of this pandemic, people don't have, people needs to have that flexibility, right? We also launched what we call Ticket Flexi, which is basically, it's a flexibility features, right? People are not sure, they can cancel anytime, stuff like that. We also have this free protection. Free protection means that all of our flight and hotel products, it's already included the free protection, right? So there are some kind of insurance on our products already, which is, again, I mean, like, that's what people need during this pandemic times, right? Another ones that we did, which is actually, I think, is very important, Ticket Clean. I think that was the first month, the second month, we launched Ticket Clean, which is actually some kind of a certification for our partners, right? Because back then, I mean, right now, everything is already like very, very following the health protocol right now. But if you think about it, on the first and second month, it was chaos, right? Even like the first 6 months, it was chaos. So we built this certification systems, whereas that we're gonna check whether this hotel or properties or places is already following health ministries, cleanliness and health standards, CHSE, right? We try to make sure that they're actually that, and then we're gonna put it as a priority on our search results, on our pages. We put it there so that people know and people feel safe, right? So that's some of the things that we do. We focus on those. Interesting bit is actually we also launched what we call Ticket Homes. Ticket Homes came out because people started to find alternative accommodations other than hotels. Because hotels usually, like, it's a big hotels. I mean, there are like hundreds of people there. People probably are not comfortable going to places that has lots of people, right? So they try to find all these private villas or like simple private accommodations, single rooms or whatever. And also we realized that a lot of people trying to get more income out of renting a room or renting a place and stuff like that. So we accommodate that and it went really well. They had the most growth during this pandemic as well. Last one was actually Ticket To Do. Ticket To Do, I'm not trying to do any promotions, but I mean, like, this is interesting because we have Ticket To Do. Ticket To Do is basically anything that you need to do during your travel essentials or before travel. What you need to do before the travel, what you can do during the travel, what you need to do after the travel. So we need to capture all these things because usually we just provide them with the place and with the flight, transportation, that's it. But then we realize that, I mean, like, whenever people want to travel, they need a lot of things, right? So we need to accommodate them with that. And because of that, we are actually one of the biggest COVID-19 testing online booking platform right now in Indonesia. very interesting. We're Tiket.com, a travel online travel company, but we're actually one of the biggest online booking platform for COVID-19 testing. You know, and I mean, like those kind of help us as well, right? During this pandemic, so that we can have like more revenues out of it. So I mean, like yeah, I mean, I think the key is travel industry. Yes, we got impacted the most, but I think there are a lot of opportunities out there. There are a lot of new things coming, you know, like new trends, right? One of the most important thing that we need to remember is that COVID-19 or pandemic, what it did to our travel industry is actually, right now, it actually opened up a new perspective for Indonesians. Previously, whenever we think about travel, what do you think? Where do you want to go? For example, I want to ask you, where do you want to go 2019? People are going to say, I want to go to Japan. I want to go to Thailand. I want to go to like Europe. They feel that that's the real travel. But then right now, 2020 opens up our opportunities and also our a new perspective. Right now, people realize that Indonesia is actually very beautiful. And there are lots and lots of new places in Indonesia that's actually probably is even better, right? For example, if you ask me, where do I want to go? I want to go to Labuan Bajo. I haven't been there. I really want it. I mean, like, I look at Sandra's picture. I was like, yeah, oh man, I should have gone there, you know? Like, I mean, like, and actually, I was planning to go to Labuan Bajo before the pandemic, and then pandemic hits. I cannot, right? So like, I really want to go there, and like, there are still like lots of other places, and that's amazing, because I think that's the thing that can make a difference, right? Because that's the power of this population. We have 275 million people. If those people actually travel within the country, right? They love this country, they love the destinations. I mean, like, we're gonna have like 275 million travelers just within Indonesia, right? I mean, like, that will definitely make everything going, right? Economics and all those things. I mean, like, I'm not saying that foreign tourism is not good. No, I'm saying it's really good for our economy as well. But people forget that domestic tourism is actually the number one one of the most important economic provider as well for a lot of these places, right?
Correct.
So yeah, I mean, I think that really gonna bring up a different kind of travel companies and travel opportunities in the future.
What is the biggest challenge and how Tiket.com coping with the challenge?
Is it during this pandemic?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think for one, for sure, we need to, especially last year, the first 6 months, it was really tough because the revenue was really bad, right? So, I mean, we need to be able to have that loss for, the thing is, we don't know how many months, right? It can be the next 2 years. I don't think we can survive, you know, if it's like that. But thankfully, starting October last year, everything started to get better. We realized that, hey, you know what, apparently Indonesian people, either they're very stubborn or they're just very agile. I mean, like, they just adapt. I mean, like, they started to travel again, starting Q4 last year. And like, Q4 last year was actually a good quarter for us. Interesting bit, in January this year, we actually had a record-breaking day for hotel room nights. The number of hotel room nights sold the most actually during the pandemic. Very funny, right? For the past 10 years, I was talking about the past 10 years, the most room nights we sold within a day was actually during the pandemic, right? Which is very interesting. Of course, flight hasn't really catch up as fast as accommodations, but right now, the trend, looking at Google's number and stuff like that, I mean, the trend is actually already very positive. Hotels, villas, flights, even like attractions, they're all showing a positive trends, right? What it means is that people started to search for it. The demand is there, you know, like it's just a matter of when are they gonna buy, right? I mean, like actually, if you know, the airports are packed today, yesterday, last week. If you go to Terminal 3, right, it was packed, like literally, like everyone's there, right? If you go to Puncak last weekend or this weekend, it's full occupancy, 100% occupancy, most of the hotels, right? So please don't go there, right? There's gonna be a huge traffic jam, huge traffic jam. So I think people, we call it there is a term out of it. We call it revenge travel. Oh. I mean, like after 1 year of
you cannot go anywhere now.
You can't really go anywhere. You're afraid, and right now you look at the numbers of COVID cases. Thankfully, it went down. But again, I mean, like we need to be very cautious. To be honest with you, right now I'm very happy because the number is down, but I'm also very, very cautious because it happened before, right? It happened during Lebaran. During Lebaran, June, just this year, May and June this year, everyone was traveling. Everyone was crazy. Everyone was in Bali. Everyone was in Jogja. Everyone was basically just wherever they want. I did 6 or 7 staycations. That's actually also a new trend, right? People started to do more staycations. Before that, I actually never stayed in a hotel within Jakarta with my family, never. I mean, like, I just stay at my home. Nowadays, people do staycations, right? Which is also a new stream of revenue for these hotels, which is great. So, but then, you know, like just whenever it's possible, the requirements. And also, I think the most important part is vaccinations, right? This is interesting because just 2 weeks ago, we were actually the biggest vaccination provider in Jogja, Tiket.com. So we held an event, vaccination event, for I think almost 40,000, 30,000 something. It was attended by Sri Sultan Hamengkubuwono, the generals, right, and also the vice governors and all those things. So everyone supported this event, which is great. We also did one in Jakarta, very successful. Pak Sandiaga Uno was there as well. And then it was, to be honest with you, it was a side project. It was like, you know what, I think we need to do something for the industry. And I think vaccination is one of the things that we can contribute because we're the one who paid for it, for the events. What happened was everyone started to notice that. And it actually became one of our most successful marketing campaign or branding campaign, not marketing, branding campaign. Everyone started to remember Tiket.com because our vaccination events, which was very weird, right? But then it happened, and then it kind of helped us in a lot of ways. We got a lot of awareness out of that as well. So yeah.
Yeah. And how does your company prepare for the next normal? Perhaps the strategies or collaborations or the use of technologies and all that.
Yes, I think new normal is practically happening, right? It's not something that we need to look forward, right, for the next, I don't know, 1 year or so. But if you look around you, I mean, it's basically we're practically already in a new normal, but probably in the beginning era of new normal, right? So I think it's going to be evolved. Right now, again, the way we do things. For example, right now, whenever people want to check into the hotel, there are some areas that's regulated for an antigen test, for example, right? So we bundled that to the hotels. Airlines also the same, right? Most airlines, basically, we need antigen tests or PCR tests before flying, and which we bundled it, right? So you don't need to buy it separately. It can be like at one place, for example, right? So it becomes a new normal, right? And antigen test nowadays, it's already becoming that. Yeah. I mean, like before this, we took antigen test.
Yeah.
I just did that literally like 30 minutes before this, right? I mean, I just, that's it. I mean, it's something that's becoming very, very simple, right? And also affordable. So we're gonna look at these opportunities. There are already some. within the platform, within the product that we have. But I think there's going to be like even more. For example, virtual events, right? Virtual events becoming something that's new, right? Before pandemic, no one ever think about virtual events. We were like, virtual events, that's like watching a TV. But you will be surprised. I mean, like tens and thousands of people bought the ticket to watch this horror show,
yeah,
or like concerts, yeah, in virtual, which is, yeah, very interesting, right? Because if you think about it, if you need to go to an actual concerts, for example, if you live in Jakarta, it's fine. That's also the problem with Indonesia. Everything happens only in Jakarta. Nothing happens outside Jakarta, right? So that's the biggest problem before, right? People wanted to come. I mean, people need to fly, need to stay at a hotel just to watch this concert. You need to pay, I don't know, like 2 million out of the concert tickets itself, right? So it becomes a norm, right? Not just that, villas and again like alternative accommodations. There is this trend, staycations, becoming very real, right? Driving. People started to drive everywhere right now. People drove to Bali, people drive to Bali, people drive to Jogja, people drive to Surabaya. And can you imagine what it's going to bring to the economy? I mean, like, if you think about it, it's a long highway. It's a long stretch of highways, right? There's going to be like a lot of new destinations along the way, right? So what are we going to do about it, right? There's already this very really cool rest areas, right? There is this factory that's converted to rest areas. There is this like really, really cool, like a mall, really big rest area in Salatiga, if I'm not wrong, I forgot. Like it was, I mean, like those never happened before. We did not think about it, but then it happened, right? So we started to look at that. We look at the opportunities on the land travels as well right now, staycations, and also the tourism ministry call it wisata minat khusus, which is actually special tourism, hobbies, or like desa wisata, tourism village, and all those things. I mean, like, lots of interesting things happening, if you ask me.
Yeah. And how optimistic are you about the future of the Indonesian tourism?
If you ask me, again, pandemic is not the worst thing that happened to Tiket.com. As simple as that. I mean, like, yes, I'm a very optimistic person. I have always been optimistic because of my motto, right? Everything happens for a very good reason. So even though it's not happening today, and it's fine, you know, like, can do better tomorrow. And probably, you know, we're gonna get something out of it. So I think pandemic will bring us more opportunities than, of course, yes, we get the delay, we get the 1.5 years issues and stuff like that. There are lots of casualties on the industries, right? But I really hope we can go back, right? On even better than before,
bounce
right?
Back, yeah.
Yes, bounce back even faster than before. So yeah, I'm very optimistic. Again, pandemic is not the worst thing that happened to Tiket.com. That was happening in 2017, where we literally cannot pay the salary for 250 employees that we have.
Now we have
1,000.
1,000
plus around 300 outsourced for the customer care. I mean, like, yeah, I mean, we can keep them. So I don't need to worry about these good people's life beings, you know. So I think that's already something that I can be grateful of. In 2017, I need to think about, you know, what happened to these 250 families, you know, like, and we're the one who's responsible, right? Yeah, I mean, like, pandemic, the way we see things, we need to be able to see it in a different perspective, and I think it's gonna give us that spirit and excitement.
That's good. Yeah. So to bring back the tourism, what needs to be done by all the relevant parties in Indonesia?
I think the tourism ministry, they're doing a great job. They're like very supportive, super very, very supportive in whatever we do, whatever program that we have. Pak Sandi is very personal, you know, in this kind of things. He's really into the industry. He's really putting himself literally up front to see what's happening on the ground so he can make decisions fast. I think that's good, and hopefully it can continue that way. On top of that, in terms of the suppliers, partners, any travel related companies, right? I hope we all can work together even better out of this, right? I think this pandemic truly brings something. Despite our differences, you know, we're in this together. You know, so at the end of the day, let's work together, right?
Yeah.
So I think the key is we need to be able to support one another, you know, and I think that's the reason why Ticket.com is doing what we're doing. For example, we did workshops on these super priority destinations that Pak Sandi mentioned to us. We need to put more focus there. So our team actually went to these places like
Danau
Toba, Likupang, Labuan Bajo, Borobudur, right? And all these places. Why? Because we really wanted to see what's going on there. And also we had this workshop, a day workshop. We talked with them. We asked what's their problem. We asked whether is there anything that we can help them, right? We have some solutions. Can we use it, right, to help them? And I think there are some good outcomes out of it.
Okay, that's good. Yeah. Gary, let's take a walk.
Sure.
It's beautiful outside.
It is. Thankfully, it is very beautiful, yeah? The weather.
Yeah. Yep, it's good. So, anything that you would like to add on? Anything that you would like to emphasize?
I would say that I think optimism is important during this time. Mm-hmm. Hope, I think, is something that we need, right? Mm-hmm. Without optimism, there won't be any hope, right? Mm-hmm. So I think whoever we are, wherever we are in the industry, it can be, probably might not be travel industry, right? I mean, a lot of industries get affected out of this. But as long as we can keep that optimism and always look at the opportunities, mm-hmm. there is always hope to be
cool.
better, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think tomorrow definitely is going to be a better day than today, mm-hmm. for sure.
Okay, that's good.
And I love Indonesia. I mean, like, at the end of the day,
yeah.
let's focus in this country. Let's do our best here. Mm-hmm. I believe that we can do a lot more in this country. I think we're just starting.
Yeah.
Our vision is still there, it's still the same 10 years ago and now. Mm-hmm. And even today, we haven't really cracked that, I feel,
yeah.
you know? So even though we did a lot already for the past 10 years, but we can definitely do more.
Okay. Yeah. So your decision to come back home, that was one of the best decision that you ever made.
That's the second best.
That's the second best.
After
the first one was
getting married with my wife.
Okay.
For sure, right? I need to mention that, right? For sure, because she is the one who's responsible over everything that I have. If you ask me, yes, I mean, like, getting back to Indonesia, I think that really opened up the opportunity for me personally, and also I'm being able to be a part of something like Ticket.com and can really bring real impact to us, to like everyone, right? I think that's something that's really matter for me, for sure.
Yeah, that's good. To use your influence to impact others.
Yes, exactly. Yes, yeah? Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Gary.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for coming.
Thank
I'm so glad.
Much.
I'm so happy you are here.
Yes.
So stay healthy, yeah?
You too. Thank
okay.
you so much.
Thank you.
Okay.